at the time that this story began, I had already completed my first year of residency. A student from the engineering school was referred in for an accidental laser injury.
Gerard agreed to take me in, sign me the project, which was studying laser-induced optical damage of optical material. I have been studying damage with a material involuntarily. My eyeball became one of the test samples, put it this way.
Dieter, you know, was working with this very short pulse laser. As he was working on this laser, by accident, he got, you know, part of the beam in his eye. At the hospital, this intern examined Dieter's eyes and he said, wow, that is amazing.
When we dilated his eye, what I saw was a very small number of very precise, what we would call retinal burns in the very center of his retina. But these were unique in that they were very small and very precise. I was curious as to what kind of laser this was and learned what a femtosecond laser was.
Donna and I have been working with my graduate students on a special kind of lasers, ultra short pulse laser mainly. We were really happy to get in 2018 the Nobel Prize for Physics.
If you think about cutting the cornea of your eye or glass or anything transparent, the laser goes right through. And so this is why you couldn't cut something like glass or cornea with lasers before. And so I always describe it as building a laser hammer. It was not using absorption. We really just built a laser hammer to hammer those electrons right off the atoms.
I started to consult for a small company down in San Diego, and they were developing short pulse lasers for eye surgery. However, the technology what they were developing didn't have short enough pulses. So it was working, but not really well working. There were some problems. At some point I lost hope, because you keep improving and it doesn't work, you keep improving, it doesn't work, and then eventually I understood that with this particular technology, there are some issues that cannot be overcome. So, you know, there has to be some kind of a breakthrough technology coming to do this, to make this working, and that was femtoseconds.
We conducted some basic experiments. You know, as a resident or a student, as soon as you have some results, you want to present those results. Detau and I actually attended a conference, a scientific conference on lasers. Tibor was attending that conference as well.
I met Ron on a scientific conference. Ron gave a talk about his findings with femtosecond laser pulses and showing that everything what was a problem with picosecond can be overcome using femtoseconds. And then I joined the group working on the application of femtosecond lasers for eye surgery.
When a person wants to reduce their requirement to use glasses, they can undergo what's called vision correction surgery. And there were a number of procedures that were developed using manual tools, incisions, that provided some relief, but they came with some problems and complications. So there was a clinical need for precision that really led to our consideration of corneal surgery as being an appropriate place to look for femtosecond laser applications initially.
With these lasers, we can achieve micron precision. It's very, very important. The other thing is the lack of collateral tissue damage. So you have to make sure that if you are cutting a tissue, we are cutting in the right place and we don't damage the adjacent tissue and the surrounding tissue.
Nobody had ever developed a compact, reliable femtosecond laser prior to this. So the initial system that I was doing experiments with Detau took an entire room. The laser systems that ultimately have been used are, you know, the size of a shoebox. So So in the United States, most LASIK procedures now utilize the femtosecond laser. I've enjoyed, you know, over the last 20 years, just hearing people tell me I had bladeless LASIK or I had Intralase, which was the specific device that we developed. As a physician, your professional pride comes from what you do specifically with particular patients on an individual basis, but you can never have an impact on, you know, millions of patients.
Without the understanding of basic science, you could never develop technologies. You never know what is going to be an application. NSF funded Gerard. I don't think they had any idea that this will be an eye surgery product some years later and millions of people will get the surgery.
We needed this money to make new lasers and also to do curiosity-driven research. That's important.
There are many cases where accidental discoveries occur during researches, but this is the beauty of doing science. It's not completely predictable.